it's my great pleasure on behalf of the mathematics department to welcome you to the 9th annual Harvey Mudd Mathematics Conference. This conference comes to you thanks to the great effort of Professor Susan Martinozzi, for whom I ask for a big round of applause. Our inaugural speaker is Professor Arnold Barnett, who is a George Eastman Professor of Management Science at MIT. Professor Barnett specializes in all topics on operations research and has received so many awards that I'm not going to read them. I have them here. I'll just say that in 1996, he received the inaugural President's Award for Contributions to Humanity from INFORMS, the Institute for Operations Research and Management Sciences, in recognition for his consistent commitment to addressing important societal problems. Today, Professor Barnett is going to talk to us about theorems, airplanes, and fear. Professor Barnett.
Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's an extraordinary pleasure to be here for many reasons. First of all, it's good to be back in California. I've lived here long enough over my life that I actually meet the definition of California resident, according at least to your Department of Internal Revenue. And I'm very proud of that as an achievement, to be a California resident. I hope none of you takes it for granted. It's an absolutely fabulous place. I lived in the Los Angeles area for a while, and I'm extraordinarily fond of it. And even though today I went from Boston in brilliant sunshine to this area in overcast and gloom, I'm incredibly happy to be here. I'm also extraordinarily happy to be a guest of Susan Martinozzi, a PhD student of mine, of whom I'm very proud based on her research, teaching, and everything else. I'm also eager to have the opportunity to learn a little bit more about the students and Harvey Mudd. I haven't been here before. I like what I see so far, and I'm hoping to get a chance to meet you more, especially during the conference tomorrow. And tonight, after I finish this, I go on to the Jay Leno show and announce my candidacy for the presidency. So this is going to be a very exciting day for me in Southern California. The title of the talk is It Really Safe to Fly? Now, you know there's a little bit of prodding with that way of wording the question. That's not a neutral wording. So let me go back and just talk a little bit about this. By the way, my field is operations research. And to be honest, one of my hopes, and I'm sure it's the hope of the other speakers at the conference tomorrow, is that particularly the undergraduates get a sense of what operations research is. It can be very, very exciting that the kinds of mathematical ideas in which you excel really can make a difference on some of these problems. We would just as soon make a difference, and a difference for the better. So I'm happy to be here as part of a conference on that particular subject. Is it really safe to fly? Now, Susan, let's see this. Okay, well, we still ask that question, but excuse me, we're having mechanical difficulties. Okay. Oh, this is the one? Okay. All right, to put the question in a more neutral way, how safe is it to fly? Okay, and let's think about that question, mathematics, operations, research. The first question we should ask is, how should we measure aviation safety? You know, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes the most challenging question is coming up with the appropriate metric to describe what's going on, because sometimes the very way you present things has a lot to do with the way people interpret whether things are going well or badly. And one should at least think and not just take the first metric that comes to mind. Let me illustrate that a little bit. Let's say the following. It seems to me that the passenger's greatest fear in flying is of being killed in a plane crash, meaning there's a natural interest in statistics about the likelihood of that outcome. I mean, when you think about it, that's a bad outcome in flying. We're not worried anymore about getting a bad meal on the plane. They don't serve meals anymore. It's death that we're really worried about. So if that's what we're worried about, let's make sure the statistics really pertain to the risk of death. Which statistics are the most informative? Now, for a convention for this evening, I'm going to restrict my attention to scheduled passenger jet flights. That isn't to say there aren't interesting questions involving turboprops and non-scheduled flights, but we can't do everything in the course of, I mean, the talk already will be 3 hours and 55 minutes. So you can only imagine what would happen if we went to these other topics. But I just want to make clear that's a convention. Now, here's a quote from the Wall Street Journal. NTSB, meaning the National Transportation Safety Board, NTSB studies show that from 93 through 96, scheduled U.S. carriers averaged only 0.2 fatal accidents per 100,000 flight hours, less than half the fatal accident rate for the four-year period a decade earlier. Clearly, in other words, in discussing safety, they are using a metric, fatal accidents per 100,000 flight hours. As I say here, I see two problems with that statistic, fatal accidents per 100,000 flight hours, the numerator and the denominator. Why are they problematic if our aim is to talk about the risk we face when we get on a plane today, as I did and some of the other speakers did? The generic term fatal accident, which is the numerator, blurs the distinction between a crash that kills one passenger out of 300 and another that kills 300 out of 300. They're both fatal accidents. And yet somehow in terms of the overall safety of flying, I doubt we would consider the two equivalent. Also, measuring activity by flying hours misses the point that most accidents occur on landing and takeoff. In fact, I had reason to create a chart recently in the United States in jet crashes over the last quarter century or so. 94%, if we're talking about accidental crashes now, 94% of them occurred on the takeoff, climb, or descent landing phase of flight. The cruise phase, which is the overwhelming bulk of, for example, a long flight, is very close to being risk-free statistically. Only one event in the past quarter century in the United States was an accident caused by something that happened in flight. And that, you may remember, United Airlines 232 near Sioux City, where the crash actually occurred at the Sioux City Airport. But the mechanical malfunction that caused the tragedy took place at cruise altitude. In fact, if you actually look at the flight lengths of the ill-fated planes in the U.S. that suffered fatal accidents, they're actually shorter on average than flight lengths if you pick planes at random. It's 626. If you look at the ill-fated flights, it's 750 if you look at flights at random. So the notion that somehow flights tend to be concentrated toward those that have more flying hours, or those that have more mileage, or those that contribute more passenger miles, is really not substantiated by the data or by common sense. In other words, the relationship between risk and distance, or time in the air, to the zeroth power is more in accord with empirical evidence than the linear model toward the first power. Okay, and yet they used flight hours, and this was the National Transportation Safety Board. So I would say this metric is not adequate because we could have changes in the nature of fatal accidents. We could have changes in the number of flying hours that have, and if we could get a misleading impression about whether things are safer or less safe, because the changes might have nothing to do with the underlying level of safety. Okay, now here's another one. Actually, this could go on all night. It could be like Jeopardy. I'll give you the metric and you can tell me what's wrong with it. But hull losses per 100,000 departures. This was a statistic, not surprisingly, of interest to the people at Boeing. A hull loss basically means the plane has been totaled. Okay, and the idea is that if you look at the hull loss rate, you get a sense about serious accidents, and maybe that's a proxy for mortality risk. Well, maybe, but it never hurts to look at the empirical evidence. For example, I'd like you to consider two hull losses here in Southern California in the year 2000, and you may remember them. Alaska Airways off Malibu, because of the problem, the mechanical problem of controlling the plane, it plunged into the sea. 83 passengers were on board, all were killed when it plunged into the Pacific. By contrast, there was another plane that was totaled. Do you remember that? Southwest Airlines at Burbank, where it went beyond the boundaries of the airport and the news report said onto a major four-lane highway. Now, you know and I know what goes past Burbank Airport isn't exactly that. But on the other hand, there were no fatalities in that event. Both of them were hull losses. Do we really want a metric which treats that difference as irrelevant? I'm not finished. Here's another pairing. Let's go back to 2005, where an Air France plane tried to land in a thunderstorm at Toronto Airport. The landing was not a great success, and the plane was soon engulfed in flames. But there was the wondrous news that all 309 people on board had survived the crash. And that included, of course, all 291 passengers. Much worse was the fate of a Helios Airlines Boeing 737 near Athens, where all aboard the plane were killed when a problem with the oxygen system incapacitated the pilots, and thus the plane crashed. So again, a metric that treats as irrelevant a difference that strikes us intuitively as of great relevance is one that we'd rather not use as a proxy for the risk we ourselves face. There's a difference between being in a crash where everyone survives and being in a crash where no one survives. And gee, I'd rather be in the former than the latter. Okay, now, let's continue. You might say, look, why don't you just take the simple ratio passengers killed to passengers carried? I mean, that is, in some sense, a death rate, right? It is sort of a probability of being killed if you assume the recent past is a good proxy for the risk we face today. Why not simply use it? Well, I think there are reasons not to use it, despite its attractiveness. Suppose a plane hits a mountain, a Boeing 737 hits a mountain, killing everyone on board. And such an event actually occurred some years ago near Dulles Airport in Washington, where a plane hit a mountain as it was approaching the airport. And it could be a particular type of plane, a 727, a 737. If the plane is fully loaded with 150 people, you'll have 150 deaths. If it's an off day like a Tuesday and there are only 50 on board, you'd only have 50 deaths. Now, in terms of the safety of flying, do we really believe that those two events differ by a factor of three? At the same time, if I tell you that 15 people were killed in a crash, well, is it 15 out of 15 or is it 15 out of 250? In the latter case, the accident might reflect excellence in emergency procedures. And yet, if you're only using the number killed in the numerator, they would both be treated the same way. In other words, focusing in the numerator on the number of deaths can subject us to irrelevant fluctuations in the fraction of seats occupied on an ill-fated plane, and at the same time, insensitive to differences in the actual survival rate, what percentage of the people actually got off safely. And especially because, thank goodness, major fatal crashes are rare, the fluctuations associated with rare events, especially in this context, mean the statistic can bounce around wildly for reasons which, if we think about it, have nothing to do with changes in safety in the system. So I prefer not that one. You might say, well, look, we know you're from the East and you like to complain. Are you going to spend the whole time with us complaining this is false, that's false, I can think of something better, but I'm not going to tell you because I just want you to leave embittered the way we are on the East Coast? Is that? No, that's not really what I was planning to do. I think, let me tell you now what I think is a better metric. I'm not saying it's ideal, but Let me try to describe it. It's basically death risk per randomly chosen flight. And the basic idea is this. Let's say we're interested in the safety of domestic jets in the UK, in Britain, in the 1990s. The mortality risk associated with flying those. It's 1989 is about to turn to 1990. You're in a New Year's Eve party in London. The ball is about to drop on Trafalgar Square or something. And someone says, hey, come into this room here. And in the room is a gigantic urn. The person says, pick a ball at random. You pick a ball, it says British Airways flight 209, May 9th, 1993, London, Edinburgh. You take that flight. Some people are grimacing. I don't know why. You take that flight. What's the probability that if you choose this flight at random from among those in the set of interest, what's the probability you'd be killed? As you would very much lose that lottery. So in other words, the question that I would suggest may warrant our interest is death risk per randomly chosen flight. And it really is the answer to a question, if a person chooses a flight at random from among those of interest, and I gave as the example UK domestic flights over the 1990s, what is the probability that he or she will not survive it? And of course, I mean for a reason related to an aviation problem. Okay? Now, I would argue, and it need not be obvious to you now, but this death risk per flight statistic, I believe, has conceptual advantages compared to the other statistics just discussed. What conceptual advantages? Well, if you actually work out the formula, and by the way, it's not a hard exercise in probability. I know it's very good to see many students here, and I think some of you have had probability. You could do this. If we sat down, we could work through it. First of all, the formula for death risk per randomly chosen flight ignores length and duration of the flight, which are virtually unrelated to mortality risk. Secondly, it weights each crash by the percentage of passengers killed. Now, that deals with the objection to passengers killed over passengers carried, because if the plane hits the mountains and everyone is killed, it's 100% whether the plane is full, it's 100% whether the plane is half full. At the same time, if it's 15 out of 250, then the survival rate of something like 93% is noted, as opposed to 15 out of 15, where the survival rate is zero. So I think in that sense, it captures something which other of the measures didn't capture. It's easy to calculate, because thank goodness, for most flights, they land safely. So it's really only a few of them. We even have to look at the percentage killed. And it's also, I think, easy to understand, because it is a probability. People like the question, what are the odds? So I would argue this, if we're going to have a simple measure, then taking into account the empirical realities and the desire for ease of exposition and other characteristics, this is one we might use. And I myself have used it, you know, in my work. Now, you might say, okay, come on, give us a number. All right, you have one. It turns out, did you know, ladies and gentlemen, most jet flights in the world are scheduled jet flights on domestic carriers in the first world, such as the US or Canada or Japan or the individual countries of Western Europe or Australia, a big country which depends on a lot of domestic flights. About two-thirds of the jet flights in the world are in this category, so this is not an eccentric category. It turns out, I'll just give you a number, that in the 1990s, the death risk per flight was 1 in 13 million, if you do the computation for all the first world domestic jet flights. By the way, people who want the transparencies, I'm sure we'll make them readily available to you, so you can, in this magic information age. But then the question is, and this is a question which really is quite important to us as mathematicians, is we say 1 in 13 million and have a certain sense of what it means, or think we have a sense, but a lot of people don't have a clear sense. What does it mean to have a risk of 1 in 13 million if you board a scheduled domestic jet flight at Ontario, for example? And I remember I would tell this number to people, and a lot of people are afraid to fly. It's kind of lucky. You know, the reason I started work in this area is that I was a junior faculty member. I was afraid to fly, and I thought, how can I sublimate my fear in a way that might be publishable? So I started working on it, but I was very, very lucky in this following sense. I really was doing it because I was afraid. I'm not just saying that for effect. But because a lot of people have anxieties, there's more interest in work in this topic. If I'd done work with the same mathematical models in plant physiology, there would have been much less interest in the work. You know, maybe a marigold here or there would call me up and say, what are you doing? But it would not have had the same effect. But in any case, so I get to talk to people. And of course, now with the web and email, I get various messages, as I'll tell you. But in any case, so you try to say someone who's nervous about flying, the risk is only 1 in 13 million. And you know what people will say to me? I'll be the one in 13 million. Never mind where this egotism comes from. So I was trying to think, are there ways of letting people know how utterly rare 1 in 13 million is? And I thought that in my home state of Massachusetts, we have a state lottery, as other states do, and there's a game in it called Mass Millions. And the probability of winning the jackpot is something like 1 in 5.2 million. And so I said to people, do you realize that if you bought a lottery ticket on your way to Logan Airport in Boston, that you're 2.5 times as likely to win the grand jackpot as to perish in your next flight? Do you know how disastrously that worked in terms of comforting people? And you know, it's something I guess you have to learn by trial and error if you're as slow as I am. The reason it didn't work is that a lot of people furtively hope to win the lottery. And it's really not a great idea to juxtapose their best hopes and worst fears. And in fact, I can tell you a funny story, if you forgive me, if it's not meant as name dropping, but we at MIT, and I'm proud of it, had close ties to an administrator of the FAA, Jane Garvey, who herself is from Massachusetts. And in her written speeches, sometimes there would be lines like this about, you're in my home state of Massachusetts, you're more likely to win the jackpot in the lottery. And I said to her once, I said, you know, I really don't like that statistic so much. She said, and I said, I know you quote in your speeches. And she said, oh, I don't like it at all either, and I never quoted it. They put it in the speech, and she simply ignored it. But in any case, it turns out this is something you learn, that even though the statement was correct, if the aim was to comfort people, you know, it really didn't work. But then, finally, I kept thinking, what way of putting it? And I said, now look, let's suppose you were to take a flight every single day, Saturdays, Sundays, and holidays included. Do you realize that on average you'd have to go 36,000 years at a rate of 1 in 13 million risk per flight before you'd finally succumb to a fatal accident? 36,000 years. And you know, then I got people suddenly changing their appearance. Their eyes would suddenly change. 36,000 years? I'm not going to live 36,000 years. Now, you know, if one were mean, one could say, well, don't forget, that's an average. I mean, for you, it could be tomorrow. But seriously, ladies and gentlemen, there is an issue here, a serious point, and that is, it's easier for people to internalize the concept of average, of mean, than the concept of variability, of standard deviation, etc. And while that wasn't really my aim in putting the statistic that way, nonetheless, it certainly has served to comfort people, perhaps more than it should. But still, that is a wonderful record. That was the 1 in 13 million. Maybe I should give you, though, some other numbers and talk about them a bit. First of all, here's a chart that I think we should look at. Again, the probabilistic calculations are not difficult, but we should never be ashamed of doing simple math. You know, sometimes people think, well, if everyone understands it, it can't be too deep. But the problem is we should be self-confident enough that we know the math, that if we do something simple, it's because that's all we really need to make the general point, and everything else would be a form of pretentiousness. So I think one of the wonderful things about being, whether it be from Harvey Mudd or MIT, is that they know we know the math. If we do long division, it's because long division is all it takes. Anyway, here are the answers, though. For first world domestic jet services, throughout the jet age, starting in about 1960, and in the first decade, the risk was about 1 in 1 million, the death risk per flight. As you see, it improved 1 in 3 million, 1 in 4 million, 1 in 13 million. Did you know so far in this century, in this millennium, in this decade, 1 in 70 million? There has only been one fatal jet crash in all of the first world over that period. That took place in 2006 in Lexington, Kentucky, when a computer, this is what happens when you get up early in the morning and also you're from MIT. It was a commuter plane. And it tried to take off on a runway that was too short. But in any case, this is an extraordinary record. And you know, there's a certain perspective that it gives us. You've doubtless heard about, oh, flying is worse than ever. It's a nightmare. It used to be glamorous in the old days. People would dress up for it. And some of us, I think four of us in the audience, are old enough to remember those days. But you know, there's something a little bit crazy about it. Yeah, it was more glamorous in the, let's say, in the early 60s. But the chance of being killed in the flight was 70 times as high as it is now. That's something we should bear in mind. I mean, it may not be fun to fly as much as it used to be, but we do get there. And when you think of all the things that could go wrong on every single flight, the fact that they almost never do is really quite an accomplishment. On the other hand, much as you wouldn't necessarily talk about how well the class is doing by the performance of the best student, we should understand that, in fact, first world domestic jet services are the safest air services on the earth. Let me give you some other numbers. Here's one. Well, these are the same numbers. Oh, I just say here, the statistical significance of this pattern of continuous improvement is beyond question, as is the discontinuous jump from the 90s to the early part of the 21st century, meaning that even though these are rare events, the theory of probability helps us to assess what might represent mere fluctuations as opposed to what seems to represent a difference that can't readily be explained by chance alone. And this systematic improvement that we see cannot be explained by chance alone, or as you might say in the statistics courses, the differences are statistically significant. The probability of getting the record we got earlier this century, in the last 7 years, based upon the patterns that prevailed before that, is minuscule that we would do so extraordinarily well. So it's not just a matter of a fluke that contributes the numbers we saw. It seems to be an enormous ability to learn from past mistakes and to achieve improvement. Here's, by the way, the figures for international jet services in the first world. So that would be a flight, for example, from LA to Vancouver, or a flight from New York to Zurich, for example, one city in the first world to another, but a change in countries. And you notice the numbers are good, but they are not as good as those in the domestic services. Now, like Fox News, you know, I report, you decide. I'm not saying I have an immediate explanation for that, which I'm totally comfortable, but if you look at it in period after period after period, you see this discrepancy, then to say, well, it's just a temporary fluctuation, after a while starts to get old. But if you want to see another set of numbers that are not as comforting in a certain way, these are the ones for developing world jet services. So a flight from, let's say, Jakarta to Bangkok, or for that matter, a flight from Nairobi to Lagos or something, or in Latin America, from Sao Paulo to Buenos Aires. Here the numbers are again low in the scheme of things. 1 in 100,000 is not a high number, even though it's higher than the numbers we've seen. At the same time, we do see the pattern of continuing improvement, And once again, as in the first world, the improvement has increased rapidly toward the end of the period. So now they actually have 1 in 2 million as opposed to 1.5 million the period before. So in other words, if you look at the three types of aviation we've described, in every one of them, a very substantial improvement from the beginning of the jet age to the most recent days, without question. In every single case, if you study the numbers further, and in percentage terms, more than 90%. On the other hand, the differences between the first world and the third world have not really diminished, at least as a ratio, from the early period to the last. In fact, let me give you a quick comparison here. Now, the first column is the developing world numbers you just saw. The second is for all first world flights, and that's in some sense a melange of the domestic flights and the international ones. I wanted to make the comparison fair, so if we're going to have international flights in the left, we should have them in the right. And once again, you see parallel patterns of substantial improvement, but on the other hand, we see that the differences remain. Here it's a factor of 7 at the beginning, 700,000 to 100,000. It's a factor of 15 at the end, 30 million to 2 million. Now look at those numbers, and here's a little question for you that we would consider next, and that is, do these last differences mean that given a choice between flying a first world airline and a developing world one, one should opt for the former? Meaning, you understand the question. Let's suppose I have an opportunity to make a choice out of Los Angeles. I'm going Los Angeles to Sao Paulo, let's say, and I could do it on, let's say, American, or I could do it on Varig of Brazil. I'm not even sure which airlines fly that route, to be honest, so this is meant to be a bit hypothetical. Could we reason, well, first world airlines have a way of doing better than third world airlines, so maybe it's safer for me to fly the American Airlines plane? The question is that a sound inference given the numbers we have? I have a feeling some people say, sure it is, but they're afraid to. They say, no, it's a trap. He's from the East, remember? So, well, there is a problem with that reasoning, ladies and gentlemen, and that is, consider the so-called ecological fallacy in statistics, where you say, John is better in math than Bill. I have a problem in trigonometry. I should go to John rather than Bill. And you might say, is that a logically tight sequence of statements, a syllogism? And the answer is no. Because even if John is in general better than Bill in math, it may be that trigonometry is an exception to that rule, that it represents Bill's strong point and John's weak point. In other words, a pattern that prevails in the aggregate doesn't have to prevail in every particular circumstance. The only circumstances in the world in which you really have a choice between first and developing world airlines is on routes between one city in the first world and one city in the third world. If you think about it, realistically looking at schedules, there's no point in comparing domestic flights in Canada and those in Nigeria, because if you're in Nigeria, you don't have the opportunity to fly Air Canada on domestic flight, or vice versa. In the places where it might matter, is there a difference? And don't just look at aggregate statistics, let's look at the specialized statistics. Well, that's very difficult to do, because if you go to any gathering of statistics, they don't really break them down into cities from the first world to the third world. But that is why God created graduate students. Because I've been lucky, and I have worked with students, and I'm very proud of my work with Susan and Susan's work with me, but she didn't work on this particular topic. But we actually went back to find out on a route like, let's say, Tokyo, Jakarta, how many flights were first world airlines like JAL, how many were developing world airlines like Garuda. We used a method known as counting, actually old-fashioned counting, how many in each category based on the schedule books. And we were able to make the comparison. And you know how it came out? Well, you don't know if it came out because I can't get this thing. Here. On the routes on which they compete, the mortality risk statistics were the same. And part of the reason for that, once you get this pattern and you see that these overall differences of a factor of X wither away on the routes on which they compete, you start to come up with explanations. It turns out, for example, that if you actually look at the circumstances of accidents, there was a crash, for example, of an American Airlines plane in Colombia in the mid-1990s. Now, it turns out that people said this could never have happened at Salt Lake City. The plane hit a mountain. But apparently, the air traffic control was less complete than it would be here. Gorillas had blown up some of the radar towers, so it was even weaker than it otherwise might have been. And routine warnings that would have appeared in Utah if a plane were off course and headed toward mountains were not available there. In other words, what you really find is that the hazards in the developing world in infrastructure and otherwise affect all the airlines that fly there and not just the local carriers. So the notion that by flying British Airways or JAL, you are less vulnerable to those hazards is, statistically speaking, a bit of an illusion. Okay, and that's an example of the kind of thing we are able to do with simple math as long as we remember not to jump to conclusions and to think it's so obvious there's not even any need for math. So as I say, on the routes on which first and developing world airlines compete, the difference in their safety records withers away. And I say this has happened before, because I've done this comparison with the aid of students, and again, we get the same result, that on those routes on which there's competition, the risk statistics are the same. To put it crudely, the third world countries perform at their best on those routes, and the first world countries, in some sense, perform at their worst, and there is a convergence that goes on. Actually, let's see. Come on. Susan, an emergency has arisen, an in-flight emergency. Okay, and here's a rule of thumb, by the way, that on routes, on nonstop routes on which carriers compete, you know, it very rarely is there a reason related to safety to prefer one carrier flying the route to another. That's something I personally take away from it. When I fly, it never occurs to me, to be honest with you, and I certainly would be honest, that in terms of safety, it would never occur to me that if I were flying, let's say, from here to New York, that I would say I really want to take United rather than American for reasons of safety. I just don't even think about that. I don't believe it. One can't defend that point of view from statistics or from anything else we know about the regulatory structure or the way the airlines work and cooperate on matters of life and death. So this is something we learn. In other words, where are we? In the first world, we're in a very good position that fatal accidents on first world jets are on the verge of extinction. It's absolutely amazing what they have been able to achieve. On the other hand, people, many a near extinct species has staged a massive comeback. In other words, even though, you know, you could argue, I would not, by the way, you could argue that to be worried the next time you get on a flight at Ontario, gee, I'm really frightened of flying, in terms of accident risk, it's on the same order as being afraid to go into the supermarket because the ceiling is going to collapse. I mean, when risks get extraordinarily low, we effectively treat them as zero because otherwise we would be paralyzed. We're taking non-zero risks that are small all the time. And these risks have actually gotten to the level where they are extraordinarily small. And as I said, this is a staggering achievement. I only wish I could do one thing in my life nearly as well as people have managed to protect us when we fly on airplanes. But on the other hand, the fact that things are great now doesn't mean they have to stay great, because we can imagine reasons that things might be worse in the future than they are now. What are examples of that? Well, one of those concerns collision risk on the ground, runway collisions. The worst aviation accident in history was a collision on the ground in Europe which killed 583 people, a crash of 2 747s, one of Pan Am, one of the Dutch airline KLM. This happened in 1977, so I guess 30 years ago. That's, and the question is, could these events become more numerous, especially as air traffic increases? I mean, common sense says that even if in the past at low levels of traffic, such collisions were very rare, that doesn't mean they have to be rare as the traffic increases, right? And by the way, while they were rare, they certainly were not non-existent because, as we know, there was a terrible runway collision here at LAX. When, do you remember it, people? When a U.S. Airways jet was landing to the west around sunset, and the glare made it impossible for the pilots to see that there was a commuter plane on the runway on which they had been cleared to land. And the plane hit the commuter plane with numerous fatalities on both planes. But still, these events have been relatively rare. Now, what about the future? It turned out, see, we're lucky to be in a field, if you join us in operations research, where the problems get coming. Because I had worked on these statistics about aviation safety, people would sometimes say, can you help us on particular problems? And one particular problem that came up was about runway collisions. And what about the risk of runway collisions? Are they poised to return? We've had very, very few of them, but may we see more of them in the future? Oh, no, not this again. I'm sorry, Susan. Thank you very much. The FAA asked the speaker to help investigate how might the expected growth in U.S. airport traffic affect the risk of fatal runway collisions. Meaning, would we expect it to be a linear phenomenon, that if you double the amount of traffic, you double the risk? Would you expect it to be quadratic, where if you double the traffic, you quadruple the risk? Maybe cubic. Double the traffic, you increase the risk by a factor of 8. And let me tell you very briefly about what we did. You see, beyond the question of what is the risk level now, there's the natural follow-up, what about the future? And this is a specific question in that regard. Anyway, you might argue that to a first approximation, you might expect the airport's risk of a runway collision would vary with the square of its annual number of operations. In other words, the second power rather than others. Why might this be? Well, I can think of two reasons. If you have N planes, and you say, well, what are the number of pairs of planes that could crash? One could crash with two could crash with N, et cetera. Anyways, many of you may have seen, remember the combinatorial formula, N choose two? I don't know whether the same thing happens here at Harvey Mudd as happens at MIT, but if people clink their glasses on a toast, there's always someone who's going to compute how many clinks there had been, and will sort of write the combinatorial formula on a napkin or something. Anyway, you could say that, but that may not be persuasive, because if there are N flights over the period of interest, well, if the first is in January and the second is the next December, it's kind of silly to talk about whether they could crash. But I think there's another argument that is more persuasive to me, and that is, let's just consider a suburban street where you have a two-way street and then a one-way street which has a stop sign at the end of it before the intersection of the busier two-way street. Let's suppose traffic increased both on the one-way street and the major street by 20%. What would we think would happen about the number of accidents because a car went through the stop sign over on the one-way street? Well, if there are 20% more cars, then to a first approximation, I would think the number of cars that violate the stop sign would go up by a factor of 1.2, right? In other words, a proportional increase. On the other hand, there's a double whammy. The very fact that there's more traffic on the busier streets means that if you do violate the stop sign, the chance there's another car nearby and thus you have a collision would itself go up by roughly a factor of 1.2. So it's really 1.2 squared. In other words, it is a simple quadratic model that comes to mind. On the other hand, though, to say, okay, well, quadratic makes sense, so let's assume that it will be quadratic, that's inadequate, because you can easily think of circumstances in which that reasoning could be sloppy. For example, do you really believe on the freeways here that if the amount of traffic doubles, that the mortality risk quadruples. It could actually go down, right? Because as there's more traffic, the traffic moves slower. And thus, those accidents that occur will tend to occur at lower speeds and have a lesser chance of creating fatalities. I mean, when you think about it, on the I-10 near downtown Los Angeles at 8 a.m., you're not going to have massive fatal collisions when all the cars are going 8 miles an hour. So in other words, we don't want to be too glib about this. But it turns out that in this setting, now come on, I would say the following. Wherever possible, it's desirable to go beyond merely stating conjectures and to test hypotheses and approximations against empirical evidence. In other words, we think it could be quadratic. Can we come up with evidence to that effect? Well, that's the next step. You say, is there evidence around? And if you inquire, sometimes it does appear. It turned out that at FAA, a panel of experts, pilots, air traffic controllers, etc., had studied in detail all 292 runway incursions in the U.S. in 1997. An incursion means that something has gone, a plane has gone beyond where it should have been on the runway, and it was a violation of the rules that might, in principle, have caused trouble. Now, in reality, many of these things are very minor. It's the equivalent of stopping for a stoplight but going 2 inches beyond the white line. It really didn't have the potential for causing an accident, but it is, according to the technicality, an incursion. Anyway, though, it turns out, though, that there is an interesting subset of those data. The 40 U.S. runway incursions that the experts said had extremely high accident potential and which took place under conditions of reduced visibility, like nighttime, sunrise, or sunset. Even if a plane is cleared to land on a runway on which another plane is sitting, if it takes place in the middle of the day, you're not going to have an accident because people will see what's wrong. It's at night that that's dangerous. It's during fog that it's dangerous, or during sunrise, sunset, where glare might prohibit things. Well, there were 40 of these events. None of them actually caused deaths, but they really were the kinds of things there, but for fortune, it would have been a runway collision of major magnitude. Well, the question then comes, at what airports did they occur as a function of the traffic of those airports? If the quadratic model were correct, then we would expect that the airports with 500,000 operations per year would, on a per capita basis, suffer roughly 4 times the annual number of these alarming events as those with 250,000. You see what I mean? The quadratic model, that when we look at the spread of these events across airports, does it really tend to be concentrated toward the bigger ones in the direction of a quadratic model? And to put it very briefly, the test was passed with flying colors as a quadratic model, if you actually looked at those events, while interestingly, the adjacent hypotheses of a linear relationship and a cubic relationship failed statistical test. The cubic, for example, would imply that almost all the events took place at the very busiest airports, such as LAX, such as Dallas-Fort Worth, such as Chicago O'Hare. And while they had a disproportionate number of the events, it was not anything to the extent that the cubic model would predict. So these are circumstances in which the quadratic model has some plausibility. There is some empirical support for it in an interesting data set. So therefore, one might be comfortable using it in a projection to answer the question. And this n squared rule was part of a broader analysis which estimated that overall, runway collisions over the next 2 decades could cause about 800 deaths in the US and 200 serious injuries. Actually, if something goes wrong on a plane, you're much more likely to be killed than seriously injured, it turns out, statistically speaking. And that, by the way, is a mid-range figure. So the point is that even though we've had very few of these events, when we consider the implications of a quadratic model and other factors, we might expect things to be much worse. Another circumstance that might, we might think is worse is that changes in air traffic control in both Europe and the US could bring an increased risk of mid-air collisions. In Europe, they have a different system for each country. And the hope is to consolidate. Now, that may make a lot of sense, but in the short run, there's bound to be a little bit of confusion. And you know the classic learning curve in industrial sociology? That at the beginning of something new, you know, you start to make mistakes that had not been anticipated. In the US, we now have, do you know how planes fly? They actually fly on the aerial equivalent of the interstate highway system, much as a lot of people going from here to the east will take the I-10. The planes take the aerial equivalent of the I-10. They can't just fly direct routes from origin to destination. Well, now it's being said we should move to a system of direct routes. Now, that would certainly save fuel, save time, and it would be fine, except that picture it from the point of view of the air traffic controller. Now the planes are basically flying on a grid, you know, east to west, north to south. Under the new system, it might almost be a little bit like gas molecules, you know, bouncing around randomly in the sky. And so there is a danger that a system which is near perfect today could be less so in the future. Anyway, so you could say these are examples of things that, in terms of accidents, that could be more of a problem in the future than they have been in the recent past. At the same time, I think we should avoid being overly pessimistic. Let me tell you the end of the story about the study we did about runway collisions. I said potential problems don't have to turn into actual ones. What actually happened was that when the FAA looked at the projections we made and looked at the reasoning and said, gee, this seems to make sense, it ordered 25 new systems, state-of-the-art ground radar, for 25 mid-sized airports. The larger airports were already going to get these systems. So you could say that the very fact of acknowledging that there's a danger might lead to compensating steps so that the danger doesn't actually materialize. In fact, when the FAA gave the list of the names, they called it a joint FAA-MIT decision. Now, why did they do that? Because when people were going to complain, why is my city not on the list, they would say, hey, we didn't do it. Some nerd at MIT did it. And so it was some scientific criteria, leave us alone. But in any case, it's very exciting to work with real problems, to work with people who, by and large, are much more reasonable than they are according to the stereotype. We have that opportunity, and tomorrow in the talks, you'll see it again and again. And even if we think about it, something like the free flight paths I described to you, it's not self-evident that they will create an increase in risk. Now, this is, granted, I did it, so it looks kind of tragic. But under the present routing, if a plane wanted to go from the start of the white arrow there to the end of the white arrow there, on present paths, it might have to go down to the equivalent of the I-10 and fly that and then fly back north, south, east, north. And a plane going basically from the start of the green line to the end of the green line would again have to fly on the interstate route, on the scheduled route, and go up to the common point and fly north, east, south. But if they didn't have to fly on these prescribed routes, then they would never get close to one another, right? Under the present arrangements, they will be flying a common route for a good part of the way. And thus, if they happen to converge on this point very close to the same time, there could be a danger. But if their routes don't, on the straight line routes don't even take them near one another, that danger is reduced. So in other words, we shouldn't simply say that as you change the routing, it automatically makes things more dangerous. You have to weigh the various considerations. One last thing, though, and I appreciate your patience, but let me not impinge upon it much more. Look, we can't end a talk like this without at least some reference to the issue of airline security. Everything I've been talking about up till now concerns primarily accidents and accident risk. But we know, obviously, there are questions about security. But how do we think about them? And you know, some people, and there may be some in this audience, may take the attitude, we've heard enough about aviation security. And indeed, the 9/11 Commission suggested a certain impatience with recent aviation security measures when it described them as, quote-unquote, fighting the last war, meaning now we know what to do if they try to get into the cockpit again, but that's not the way they're going to attack next time. So we're fighting the last war, and in that sense, not thinking about the next war, which may not involve aviation at all. Okay? Well, you know, there may be something to that viewpoint. But on the other hand, we might note the following statistics. More U.S. civilians were killed by terrorists during air journeys, meaning from the time you enter the airport of origin to the time you leave your airport at your destination, that's an air journey, than during any other activity. And on a per-hour basis, the terrorism death risk during air journeys was 600 times higher than at other times. And, ladies and gentlemen, these statistics are all based on the 35-year period prior to 9/11. Susan is very familiar with them because these statistics, I'm proud to say, appeared in her first paper, which she worked on, and I was honored to work with her. And our results were vetted by people, and they appeared in a journal published by the American Statistical Association. This is pre-9/11. So to think of 9/11 as just an aberration, as opposed to a continuation of a pattern, may be unwise. Similarly, what about since 9/11? Well, we haven't seen any spectacular events against aviation, or so we think, but let's just go down a quick list. Since 9/11, there was the shoe bomber's attempt to destroy a transatlantic jet. You remember that? You know, it turns out that people in the industry say that was a much closer thing than we may have realized at the time. And in fact, what may have saved us is the fact that Americans don't smoke as much as Europeans do, because the would-be terrorists lit a match. And because we're not used to the smell of a lit match, people were immediately alerted. Whereas if we were used to it because of the smoking, maybe there would have been a bit of hesitation, and that might have meant the difference between stopping the event and its going forward. You may remember a 2002 shootout at LAX that left several dead and injured, the simultaneous destruction of two Russian jets in 2004, the 2006 plot to destroy 10 transatlantic jets with liquid explosives, which is why we now have the new restrictions about how we have to have containers 3 ounces or lower in a plastic bag, etc. More recently, the 2007 firebombing at Glasgow Airport. You know, I think there are several things. One point you might bear in mind is something that a terrorism expert said. We might think, look, why would they even go after aviation? They've made their point, they can get hits elsewhere. But that might be precisely the point. He says, instead of more accessible targets like subways and commuter trains, hotels, and tourist destinations, last summer's plot to bomb more than 10 U.S. airliners was aimed at perhaps the most internationally hardened target since 9/11, commercial aviation. In other words, in the terrorist mindset, the very fact that we've done so much to protect aviation means if they can succeed in destroying planes, then the demoralization and the sense we don't know how to handle them will be all the greater. In any case, those of us who are involved in aviation work are not comfortable, I would think, with the idea, well, it's fighting the last war. And the counter-argument might be that the terrorist fascination with aviation long preceded 9/11 and has evidently persisted since then. There is perhaps nothing wrong with fighting the last war when it resembles the one before that and the one before that, and when we lost the last war disastrously. Then the question is, what do we do? That itself could obviously be the subject of a very long talk, but I just want to talk to you very quickly, as I end up, with two possibilities. One suggestion was made, it turns out, by the New York Times, where it wondered whether or not we should ban laptops from the passenger cabins on jet planes. Here's what the Times said. Well, what happens now? This is actually Avita saying that. In terms of how do we respond to the threat of terrorism, which we believe is large. There are new proposals popping up everywhere. Here's one from the New York Times. It argued we should stop allowing laptops in airplanes. Separating people from their laptops will be painful. although some people could surely use the time to go over reading material or even revert to pen and paper. For now, the surest way to keep dangerous materials out of the cabin is to keep virtually all materials out of the cabin. Now, one should give the Times credit for audacity and its logical thinking. If we worry that these onboard laptops could be used as detonators, and we don't know how to detect that possibility, keeping them out of the cabin may be the way of doing it. On the other hand, there is a question might arise in the mind of the mathematician. Are they crazy? I mean, think about it, ladies and gentlemen. It's very easy, if you're the editors of the New York Times, to say something to the effect that, well, if you play Sudoku at home and do the laptop on the plane, why don't you do the Sudoku on the plane and the laptop at home? But that's not the choice, ladies and gentlemen. In reality, the time you don't spend working on the plane is time you'll spend at home not being able to play with your kid. It could mean massive dislocation and inconvenience. It could mean people would try to use the video conferencing more than flying, because flying now is so much more onerous. It could mean that instead of taking two quick trips, transcontinental, west coast to east coast, you combine them into one, so you'd only have dead time on two legs, rather than four. In other words, this is a very radical proposal. I mean, of course we don't want to take any risk, but we can't take the attitude that we'll bear any price, however enormous, to achieve any increase in safety, however minuscule. Now, there's one last thing, and that is, I've been worried about something. Ladies and gentlemen, these terrorist events tend to occur in groups, not just one. It's on September 11th, there were four planes destroyed. And as you may, did you see United 93? It points out that after the first plane, you know, American 11 got into trouble, the people at FAA heard the hijackers boasting, we have, quote unquote, some planes, not one plane, but some. And when you think about it, in many terrorist acts recently, such as the bombings of the London Underground or the commuter trains in Madrid or elsewhere, it's not one event, but rather several, which means that suppose a plane plunges from the sky for reasons unknown. What should we do, knowing that terrorist acts against transportation often are followed by others within minutes? In other words, now we might think certain planes in the sky are in imminent danger. What do we do about that? Well, for one thing, it obviously takes a little bit of time to ascertain the plane has plunged from the sky, even if you don't know why, and to communicate this information. The question is, well, how much time will we have between the first event and the subsequent events, time in which, in principle, we might try to do something to stop them? Well, here's some empirical evidence. If we look at the fatal terrorist bombings against air and rail since 9/11, and I list six of them there, as far as I can tell, they are the only major ones in the world. Madrid, Moscow, Russia, London, Mumbai. In Madrid, there were 10 explosions within 3 minutes. In Moscow and Russia, in those rail events, there was only one event. There were no follow-ups. In the Russia, in the planes, two explosions within 2 minutes. In London on the underground, all three explosions took place within 1 minute. In Mumbai, seven within 11 minutes. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I can't imagine any scenario in which you really would be able to take action less than about 5 minutes. When you think about all those things that have to happen, you know, even for the plane to plunge to the ground, that takes quite a while, often. Almost all of these events imply we will not have enough time. And if we try to do something, attempts to avoid these emergencies can create other risks, like those of mid-air collisions if planes suddenly try to get to lower altitudes so they're less vulnerable to explosions. You know, if you really apply optimization rigorously in terms of what should we do that is least harmful, the optimal strategy, tragically, might be do nothing except hope. That the chance that doing something will benefit is very low, whereas the chance that the attempts to deal with it will cause collisions and other mortal events is higher. So that it's incredibly dissatisfying when you think something terrible is about to happen and you don't know what to do about it, but maybe sometimes you don't know what to do about it. In other words, the point I make is that terrorism poses a risk to us that it's harder to understand what the risk is and what we can do about it. I worry about that every single day. I can tell you, Susan wrote an outstanding thesis on the topic of aviation security and applying mathematical models to think about these problems. Structured, logical, mathematical thinking doesn't solve the problems, but at least we get a sense we understand them better and what it is we would really need to know most if we were to try to reach policy decisions. So, ladies and gentlemen, we come to the end. Where are we? I would end in two ways. I would say that in terms of accident risk, all factors considered, we are in an era of extraordinary success. In fact, I think the safety of first world aviation is the eighth wonder of the world. The extraordinary level of safety, we should not worry about the possibility that an accident is going to befall us. It could, of course, but the risk is so close to zero that if we're going to start worrying about that, I mean, don't we have the San Andreas Fault to worry about? We have other things to occupy our attention. But the thing that we understand less is terrorism, which brought the absolutely catastrophic event on 9/11 only 6 years ago. And whether or not aviation will see other horrific events like the one that was averted last summer when 10 transatlantic planes were to be blown up by a scheme even the head of our Transportation Security Administration said was ingenious. They really did have a scheme which, had it not been broken up by police, would have gone through all of the security precautions because they were taking several things on the plane, each of which was perfectly lethal. It was perfectly legal, none of which, sorry, Freudian slip, none of which was harmful in itself. That's the thing we have to worry about and we have to work on. In this fight against aviation terrorism, I think we better try to use the strongest tools we have at our disposal, and those are our brains. Susan has worked on that. If some of the people here were to consider a topic like that, as well as the many that will be discussed tomorrow, this is an opportunity to use the kind of training you have in mathematics for problems that urgently need clear thought. Not that clear thought answers them, but it at least increases the probability that they will be answered sooner or later. And then in the short run, there's another strategy in terms of dealing with the risk of terrorism. I remember old Piedmont Airlines, and one of its planes took off from Chicago Midway Airport, and a fire broke out in an engine, and the plane rushed back to Midway, and they dealt with it, and then the passengers were boarding the plane up the gangway, and naturally there were news photographers there, and one kid turned to a photographer as he was getting on the plane and said, "Wish us luck." Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, as we deal with the issue of aviation terrorism in 2007 and 2008 and 2009, let us all do the best we can, but also, hey, wish us luck. Anyway, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'd be very happy to answer your questions. Yes, sir.